Blessings be upon Nabi, peace be upon the messenger, and the prophets who were sent, all of them were honored. As-salatu ala Nabi, wa-salamu ala Rasul, wal-anbiya'il mursaleen.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا طيبا كما يحب ربنا ويرضى والصلاة والسلام على خير الخلق نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد Dear respected brothers and sisters Allah جل وعلا mentioned in the Quran number of verses that talk about the law of governance that حكم belongs to Allah جل وعلا Allah Jalla wa Ala says in the Quran in three verses, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهِ In one of them, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ In the other one, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ And the third one, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ The one who rules by any other law other than the law of Allah Jalla wa Ala, فَأُولَٰئِكَ they are the كافرون, the disbelievers. The second ayah, they are the oppressors or the wrongdoers. And the third ayah, they are the fasiqun, the heretics. My dear respected brothers and sisters, Islam is a comprehensive way of life and it covers all aspects of our life. And one important aspect of our life is the law of governance, how we govern ourselves, and which is called now politics. Now, the word politics in English has a negative connotation. It means that people are playing politics with each other. We are not talking about that. We are talking about the political system according to Islam. We are talking about the law of governance. Many people have a wrong idea about the early scholars and they think that they have not spoken or they did not speak about the law of governance in Islam, and that is totally wrong. Our legacy is very, very rich of all things, including the way we should govern ourselves. There are certain rules that have been set by Sharia, and there are certain guidelines that have been given to us by our ancestors, by as-salaf as-salih, radiyallahu ta'ala anhum, by our scholars in the past. Now, we have to realize, my dear respected brothers and sisters, that the early leaders, the early Muslim caliphs or leaders, they were scholars as well as leaders or governors, or you can say caliphs. We know that Abu Bakr, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, was at the top of the Islamic state. Umar ibn al-Khattab was the caliph at the top of the Islamic state. Uthman ibn Affan as well, and Ali ibn Abi Talib. After them, Muawiyah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu came, then his son, then the Umayyan period. During the Umayyan period, there was a caliph whose name was Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, who used to be considered, or some scholars considered him as one of the rightly guided caliphs. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, he became the Khalifa on 99 years of Al-Hijrah, and he died, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, just after 2 years and a few months. So he remained in power as a Khalifa for 2 years and a few months. He died 101 after Hijrah. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz is a role model for us in many aspects, but in particular, he is a role for the whole humanity, in fact, not just us as Muslims. Even non-Muslims should go and learn his law of governance or his way of governance and how he used to govern people. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz had so many pearls of wisdom, really pearls of wisdom. And among those is the quotation that we want to highlight today. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was appointed as a Khalifa by Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik, his cousin. And the system at that time was a monarchy system during the Umayyad caliphate, as you know. And it was a monarch system. But during that time, for whatever reason, because Allah Jalla wa Ala wanted goodness for the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik, he changed the order and he gave the seat or the power to Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz, and he appointed him as the next in throne, as they say, although I don't like to use this term. So Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz was appointed as the caliph by who? By Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik. Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik passed away. They were walking in his janazah, following the janazah. So when they buried him, or officially when he died, Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz became the caliph. So they just buried him and they were coming. One of the servants of Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz said, or one of the people who used to serve the monarch at that time said, I saw Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz coming from the janazah of Sulaiman ibn Abd al-Malik. And I saw him very, very sad, with a lot of sorrow and grief, as if he was regretting. Then I told him, Umar, why are you so sad? What happened to you, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen? Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz responded by saying, do you think that this is a place I wouldn't be sad in? Don't you think that I should be sad at this time? Then he said, as if he said, why? Then Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz said a very beautiful statement. He said, there is no one from the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, whether he lives in the east or in the west of this great empire, the Islamic empire at that time, except he wants me to fulfill his rights, to give him his due rights, without even writing to me, without even informing me. So Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz was so sad because he thinks that he has to give every single human being in the whole kingdom, in his state, the Islamic state, which was the only state at that time. At that time, the Islamic state was so huge, so big. It includes the whole of the peninsula. It includes most of the areas in North Africa. It includes most of Al-Sham at that time. It includes part of Al-Iraq. It includes part of India, as you know, parts of India and Iran. It includes parts of Turkey at that time. So huge Islamic state. And Umar ibn Abd al-Aziz said to him, there is no one in this Islamic state except wants me to give him his due right or her due right, even without informing me about it. My dear respected brothers and sisters, what is the whole point? The whole point here is the caliph or the Muslim leader or the sultan or any Muslim governor, call him whatever you call him, or in fact, my dear respected brothers and sisters, any person who is in charge of a few Muslims, this person should think, or the first thing should this person think of is what is the responsibility. The responsibility of all of those people, and he is in charge of them, and he will be questioned on the day of resurrection whether he has given them their due rights or not, whether he has done his job in full honesty or not. This should be the position of any Muslim person who becomes in charge of a group of Muslims. Whether he is in charge of a group of people traveling together, or he is in charge of an organization, or he is in charge of a school, or he is in charge of any small city, or he is in charge of a big Islamic state. You name it, any person who has a mas'uliyyah, he is in charge of something, he should feel the responsibility. This is how Islam looks at it. That's why, my dear respected brothers and sisters, the Islamic view towards the mas'uliyyah is totally different from the non-Islamic view. That's why Muslim leaders at that time, Muslim caliphs, Muslim governors, Muslim sultan at that time, used to run away from what? From being the khalifa. Unlike the situation now where people are running to become what? To become the leaders, the kings, the presidents, the governors, and so on. They run towards that to become in charge. Why? We have to look at it like this. Now, if you become a caliph, or if you become the Muslim leader, or in charge of a group of people, from one hand, you are doing a noble job if you have fulfilled the rights of that job, okay? And you give the people their due rights. You will be what? You will be among the seven who will be placed under the shade of Allah Jalla wa Ala when there is no shade except His shade. As you know, in the hadith, when the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Sab'a, seven people will be under the shade of Allah Jalla wa Ala where there is no shade. One of them is Imamun Adil. So there is this possibility. However, on the other side, there is the possibility of what? Of not fulfilling the rights of this position, not fulfilling the rights of people who live under you, your subjects, your flock, subhanallah al-azim. So if the person way between both, then of course and obviously he will be aware, or he will be afraid of the risk of not fulfilling this, rather than or over being joyed for what? For being in that position, that might make him as one of the adil imams, the just imams, that who is going to be under the shade of Allah Jalla wa Ala on the day in the day of resurrection. Because of this risk, most of the early scholars and most of the noble people in the early days of Islam, they used to be afraid to be in charge of other Muslims. Let us have a break, and we will elaborate on this, insha'Allah, after the break. Assalamu alaikum.
Salatu ala al-Nabi, wa salamu ala al-Rasul, wal-Anbiya'i al-Mursaleen, kulluhum mukramun.
Does Islam say, cover the, you know, what is the purpose of our lives? When you go to the grave, the believer will be asked three questions. How many, you know, destruction of marriages, of society, of family ties have come because of statements made on someone's tongue by what someone has said? What Sharia really is, think about it. We want you to think about it. Think about life. Think about your purpose in life. Think about the creator of this earth we live in. Think about how you should worship this creator and who this creator is. That's our aim behind this show here on Huda TV. Let's focus on what Islam itself says as a legal Islamic religious system.
والسلام على الرسول والأنبياء المرسلين كلهم مكرمون.
Bismillah wa salatu wa salamu ala Rasulillah. We were talking about the responsibility that any person in power should feel when he becomes in charge of a group of people, or when he becomes in charge of a small organization or a big Islamic state or a big state in general. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam said in the authentic hadith that all of us are aware of, it is in Sahih al-Bukhari and Muslim, كلكم راع وكلكم مسؤول عن رعيته. Each of you, or all of you, every single one of you is like a shepherd, and he will be questioned about his subjects. Each one of you is going to be, or is a guardian, and he will be questioned about the people under his authority. مسؤول عن رعيته. Then, in one narration, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Al-imam ra'in wa mas'ulun 'an ra'iyatihi." The imam, the leader or the governor, he is like a shepherd. He is a shepherd, and he will be questioned about the subjects. He will be questioned about them all. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Wal rajulu ra'in," and the man is a guardian, and he will be asked about the people under his authority. The wife is also a guardian, and she will be asked about whoever under her responsibility. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala anhu felt this huge responsibility when he became what? When he became a caliph. And that's why, my dear respected brothers and sisters, instead of developing wrong ideas about the law of governance in Islam, we should look at the seerah, the biography of Abu Bakr, the biography of Umar, Uthman, Ali bin Abi Talib, including even the biography of many Umayyan caliphs. Because the Umayyan caliphate has been spoiled by some sects, while we see very noble examples by Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, by even his son, by Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, by Marwan ibn al-Hakam, and then his son Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, then Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik, and then Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, as we have seen. It is true that they have some negative aspects, but generally speaking, they were considered to be scholars, and they were doing jihad for the sake of Allah Jalla wa Ala, defending the Islamic State, and there was a level of justice that has not been established even in so many years after them. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was following the model of the four rightly guided khalifas. That's why Sufyan al-Thawri considered him as the fifth of the four rightly guided khalifas. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz felt the heavy responsibility when he became the khalifa. Umar ibn al-Khattab, who was his grandfather, felt also the heavy responsibility when he became the khalifa. All of you know the statement, the very well-known statement of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, when he used to say, "Wallahi, if," like a sheep, or some riwayat, some narration say, a camel fell in any part of my dominion or kingdom, I will feel that I will be questioned about that. Either a camel or a sheep, if it flip and fell down, I feel that I will be questioned on the day of resurrection. One time Ali bin Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu saw Umar ibn al-Khattab running. He grabbed his clothes and he was running. He said, Amir al-Mu'mineen, what happened? Why are you running? He said, Nadda ibilun min ibil al-sadaqah, or nadda ba'ir, a camel from the camels of the sadaqah ran away and I am chasing it. In one narration, in the treasure of the Muslims, the treasurer found a dinar. When he was cleaning the treasure, he found a dinar or a dirham even, a small coin. He gave it to the son of Umar ibn al-Khattab. The son of Umar al-Khattab, he went to Umar ibn al-Khattab. Umar ibn al-Khattab saw it and he said, "What is this? Oh, from Bayt Mal al-Muslimin." He asked the treasurer to come and he said, "What, are you mocking me by giving my son part of the wealth of the Muslims, and I will be questioned on the day of resurrection because of that. Give it back to him and don't do it again. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, or Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, who was following the model of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, once took an apple from the mouth of his son because his son picked it from the wealth of the sadaqah, the wealth of Bayt al-Mal al-Muslimin, the treasure of the Muslims. Just one apple. So he picked it up from him. So his son, a young child, he went to his mother and he was crying. His mother collected some money and she bought apples for her children, and she gave her child one apple. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz came and saw them eating apples. And then he said to them, "Where did you get this apples from?" He was afraid that this apple was taken from the treasure of Muslims. Maybe someone can say one apple, two apples. It doesn't really matter. He is concerned about one or two apples. Then she said, "Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, I collected some money and I sent someone to buy some apples for us because you're a child. You're a child. You picked it up from his mouth and he was broken. He had a broken heart. He came to me crying." He said, "Wallahi, my heart was melting when I took the apple from my son, but I don't want to be questioned on the day of resurrection because of that apple, because of a single apple." This is the level of responsibility that they used to feel. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz once said, his wife complained about him, Fatima bint Abdul Malik. She is a daughter of the ex-caliph. She was his cousin, and she's the daughter of the ex-caliph. And she was a very righteous lady. Yet Umar ibn Abdul Aziz told her in the beginning, "Listen, Fatima, I became in charge of the Muslims. Either you give all the gold and jewelries back to the treasure of Muslims, because I'm afraid that you have not taken them rightly. You have no right over them to take them, even when you were the daughter of the ex-caliph. If you want, you do this. If you want to stay with me as my wife, welcome. If you want me to divorce you, I can divorce you." And she preferred to stay with him. His wife once said to the first minister — the first minister was a very great scholar, his name was Raja ibn Hayawah — she told him, "Raja, Ya Raja, tell Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, he did not touch me since he became the Khalifa. I have rights over him as a wife. I have rights over him as a wife. So speak to him." Raja ibn Hayawa went to Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. He's the first minister, and he was in charge of the affairs of Muslims at that time, even from the time of Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik and the caliphs before him, and they used to respect him a lot and they used to value his opinions. So he said, Raja ibn Hayawa went to Umar ibn Abdul Aziz and said, "Ya Umar, I want to speak to you about something important." He said, "Yes, yes, what is it?" So he was worried. He said, "Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, your life or yourself has rights over you, and your family has rights over you." So he said, "What do you mean?" He said, "Your family, your wife has rights over you." So Umar ibn Abdul Aziz understood. And Umar ibn Abdul Aziz responded. He said, "I thought that you are calling me for something that is really important. What is this, Ya Raja? Ya Raja, do you think that a person like me, who will be questioned about all Muslims in his kingdom, who lives under his authority, and all Ahl al-Dhimma include the Christians and the Jews who are living under the authority of the Islamic State, the subjects of the Islamic State. He said, "Do you think that a person like me, in charge of all of these, and he will be questioned about them all, will be able to have a sexual desire with his wife?" Subhanallah al-Azim. What kind of feeling he used to have. And this is the kind of feeling that we would like our Muslim leaders to have these days. My dear respected brothers and sisters, you might say, oh yes, we want the Muslim leaders to have this. But I want every single one of you to feel that responsibility when he becomes in charge of anyone. As I told you, the Prophet ﷺ said, كلكم, every single one of you, all of you are shepherds. And you are going to be questioned about your subjects, the people who live under their under your authority. And I am a father. Many of you are fathers. Many of you sisters are mothers. Many of you are in charge of Muslim affairs. If you do not fulfill their rights, you will be questioned on the day of resurrection, and those people will take from your hasanat on the day of resurrection. Listen to this hadith. This hadith started by a short story. There was a governor who was, his name was Ubaidillah ibn Ziyad. He was a governor of the city, of one of the cities in the Islamic State, either in Iraq or in Al-Hijaz, on behalf of some of the caliphs of Bani Umayyah. Okay? And they said that he was not a very just governor. He visited Ma'qil ibn Yasar. Ma'qil ibn Yasar is one of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. He visited him when he was ill, when he was in fact on his deathbed. Look though at the wisdom of Ma'qil ibn Yasar. Even when he was on his deathbed, he wants to give advices to the governors. And at that time, even if the governors, and this sometimes some books of history spoiled their reputation, but they had some fear of Allah Jalla wa Ala, a level of fear of Allah Jalla wa Ala, and a level of taqwa. That's why Ubaidullah ibn Ziyad visited this companion, and the companion responded to him by saying, let me narrate to you a hadith that I have heard it from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam says, there is none who was entrusted with the affairs of his subjects, and he died in such a state that he was dishonest in his dealings with those over whom he ruled, that the paradise is forbidden for him. Subhanallah. Look at this. So if any person who is in charge of a group of people and he does not deal with them with the best way, he will die as if he has cheated them, and he will be questioned about that. And the Prophet ﷺ said that he will not smell the Jannah. The Jannah will be forbidden for him. This is the kind of feelings any single Muslim who is in charge of other people should feel. And this is what we are calling our leaders to feel, to have. We are not addressing the leaders only, my dear respected brothers and sisters, but we would like to address every single Muslim. Every single Muslim who is in charge of any job, or who is in charge of a group of Muslims or a group of people under him, he should think of this, and he should think of that responsibility. It is a very great burden, and we have to be ready to take that burden. Otherwise, we should not put ourselves forward for such a big responsibility, except in a very, very exceptional situations, and that is not to be explained now. Jazakum Allahu khairan, my dear respected brothers and sisters, and may Allah Jalla wa Ala enable us to carry any responsibility that He entrusted us with. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Blessings be upon Nabi, peace be upon the Messenger, and the prophets who were sent, all of them were honored. Peace be upon the Messenger, and the prophets who were sent, all of them were honored. Mukramun, blessings be upon Nabi, peace be upon the Messenger. And too.